Καλησπέρα κυρίες και κύριοι, καλώς ήρθατε σε ένα άλλο πρόγραμμα του ελληνικού προγράμματος της Βοστόνης. Δευτέρα, 24 Σεπτεμβρίου σήμερα, η Ελένη δεν είναι μαζί μου, αλλά μαζί μου είναι ένας πολύ καλός φίλος, ο Μελέτης ο Πουλιόπουλος, ο οποίος πάντα μας εκπλήσει με όλη αυτή τη δουλειά που κάνει με την ελληνική μουσική, γιατί ξέρετε πόσο πολύ την αγαπώ και εγώ, και ο οποίος πραγματικά εδώ και πόσα χρόνια μελέτη κάνεις αυτό το archiving, ας πούμε.
Τουλάχιστον 35
χρόνια. 35
χρόνια. Τουλάχιστον.
Λοιπόν, απόψε ο Μελέτης είναι μαζί μας, θα κάνουμε μαζί το πρόγραμμα με το Μελέτη, αλλά συγχρόνως είναι και φιλοξενούμενος, ο οποίος θα μας πει ακριβώς ποια είναι τα τελευταία νέα, το τι συμβαίνει με αυτά που έχει βρει, γιατί ξέρω ότι έχει κάνει πάρα πολλά πράγματα. Μελέτη, καλησπέρα, καλώς ήρθες.
Ευχαριστώ.
Let's go on with what is happening right now at your music.
What's this all about, right?
What's
well,
all about?
You know, I've been away in New York, and
how
I
long?
Have a. Oh, I've been back and forth.
Oh, so you're
traveling. Whole summer was pretty much there. Yeah.
No kidding.
But it's good. It's good. I used to live in New York, so it was nice to be back, and I have a campaign, you know, to raise awareness and funding. To preserve this lost history of music that we have, so.
And we should give a little bit, 1 minute of talking about this to our friends.
Right.
To tell them that the Greek music was not only made in Greece, as we all think.
Right.
There was a lot of music, Greek music, made by Greek Americans here.
That's right.
And that there are so many unbelievable compositions that they. Am I right on that?
Oh yeah,
and
absolutely.
This is something that really intrigued you,
right?
Into doing what you're doing.
Yeah, this is how I started. I mean, we grew up with music in the house, and I wanted to know more about the songs that I heard when I was a kid, and some of those songs have never been recorded, so it's been a journey to try to find and understand, you know, all of that, and in doing that and in covering. I found out a lot about this history that's just been lost. And so I've been really pushing so that we can try to come up with a program to archive and preserve Greek music in America, because we really don't have anything like it.
So before we start getting into specifics,
yes.
Let's talk about the program and how that's going to happen.
Well,
how do you think that all these things can be preserved?
Yeah, absolutely. I have a business plan, in fact, for a nonprofit, Greek Cultural Resources,
mm-hmm.
which proposes it's a whole way of how we're going to approach this. It's like nothing else that's been done or is being done, but it solves a lot of the current problems that we have right now. So current institutions, archiving institutions that aren't handling the Greek material properly for various reasons, sometimes mostly because there's no funding, but a lot of times it's because they don't know how to catalog things, that, oh, this is Greek, okay, put it over there. So we have a carton of records and, you know, and it's just done at a collection
And it could be one
level.
Greek song with a Greek writing and a Greek whatever because they don't understand.
They don't understand.
What it is.
Right, and so we don't, and it's not just the music, by the way. It's,
it's
photographs, it's sheet music. I did a presentation at the Museum of Fine Arts this summer with Vasilis Kostas, and he was doing a giving a demonstration of the bouzouki, and he asked me to do some history, and someone pulled a fire drill. And we ended up outside on the lawn, and this young man came up to me, this student, a Greek student here in Boston, and he said, that he can't find sheet music. You know, when we were kids, there was sheet music in the stores. You could get it all over the place.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I said, well, gee, in my home, I have hundreds of pieces of Greek sheet music that are all digitized and cataloged. But I know what he's saying. He can't go to a library and find that. He can't find it in the stores.
I think that the work that you haven't done on these things, I don't think it exists in Greece. To be quite honest,
a lot of it doesn't, and that's the problem. And you know,
if you don't have it in the mainland,
right, it's not there either. Well, they're in some cases they're further along than we are in terms of the library and the archiving and all the funding that's come from the European Union. into institutions there. They're further along in some cases. But we talk about Greek music in America. I like to talk not just about the music that was composed and performed and recorded here, but also the music that came in from Greece, because we were getting records imported from the very early days from Greece, from Asia Minor, from all
Absolutely.
Over.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so it's...
We were getting records when, I mean, I'm one of the latest immigrants, let's say, came in 1976. Mm-hmm. And in 76, I don't know if you remember, there were all these little stores that they were importing back then, you know, the music of the 70s.
Right, exactly, exactly. And some of those... So if you go even further back, back to the old 78s, what was happening at the time was the record companies were targeting songs, were targeting certain recordings to America. And there were songs about the Xenithia, there were songs, and they were extremely popular here, but they weren't so popular in Greece, or there were different versions, or there's mm-hmm, that. Mm-hmm. So I had a campaign here in Boston. I approached the leaders of the community that I knew, or that I was referred to, for funding, for support. And when I say support, I don't mean, okay, write me a check. I mean, let's engage here. Let's get this done. What do you think about this plan? And, you know, it was what it was. And now I've carried that off to New York. And I'm so happy because there's such a great reception there. People get it. And the engagement is very
really
strong.
Nice.
It's very nice.
But this is really nice.
I've stepped it up, Thanasi. I talk about now our lost history because it's history and culture. And so out of the things that we've lost, okay, the mm-hmm. very first recordings made anywhere in the world, first Greek recordings, they were made here in 1896, lost. Eight songs, eight records, lost. Okay.
Do you know what they are? What they were composed?
Yes, yeah, I actually have a list because we
okay.
have a and the first talking Greek film, people like movies. Well, the first movie with sound was made in New York.
Made here.
Yes. Tetos Dimitriadis. And this was done in April of 1930.
Wow.
It was great. It was 1,600 people flooded the theater in New York, the Earl Carroll Theater, to see this movie. Think about it, right? The first talking picture in Greek. And then it disappeared. And it's lost. It was never saved. So as Greeks, we seem to be very good at throwing things out or not caring.
So did you ever find out which theaters they played at?
Oh, yeah. I have a lot of research, you know, and what I've done, I actually have a little slide here, but I know we can't show it, but I'll show you. So this is the first film, and this was an ad. Igrothia...
Tousakati.
Tousakati, right?
Yeah.
So
Διαμίαν μόνον ημέραν. Το παίξανε μόνο μία μέρα.
Μόνο.
Η γροθιά του Σακάτη, η πρώτη εν το κόσμο ελληνική ομιλητική ταινία. Μ' αρέσει και ο τρόπος που το γράφουν. Είναι,
yeah,
δεν είναι όπως είναι τώρα, είναι πιο ωριό.
Yeah.
Μια πρόβα στα, δεν λέει στα γρήγορα, λέει στα γλίγορα.
Yeah.
It used to be a way of saying that.
Yeah.
Κωμικό φωνοκινηματογραφικό σκίτσο με μοντέρνα ελληνικά τραγούδια. Επίσης απολαυστικών ελληνικών πρόγραμμα, έξι συνεχείς παραστάσεις. Τιμέ δολάριο ένα.
Ένα δολάριο. Which was a lot of
στο
money.
Earl Carroll Theater. Αυτό yeah. λοιπόν είναι πραγματικά πολύ πολύ ωραίο. Το βρήκες αυτό σε εφημερίδα.
Σε εφημερίδα, ναι. And I have other things. I had the review that came out afterward that talked about 1,600 people. Now these are in the... This is research I'm doing in the Greek newspapers. And what I found was that, you know, because of the problem with the Greek, and because there was a censorship that was going on at the time, that all films had to be reviewed by a state censorship bureau. So the title at first was called, it was called The Punch of the Hunchback. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't know how you would say,
yeah.
right?
But and, hunchback, Sakati is somebody who, something's wrong in his body, something happened to him and his
yeah.
body, but it's not exactly a hunchback, it could be somebody that his hand is like this, or his leg is, you know.
Okay, so okay. from that we have, well, we have the hunchback and his might, and fist of a cripple. These are three different
translations. That's the best one.
Fist of a cripple?
The fist of a cripple. That's the
yeah.
best, you know.
And so it's sad to me. Actually, there were two songs that came out of this movie, and I have them on record. But it's sad to me that we've lost that. We've lost a lot of our newspapers, Thanasi. We have incomplete microfilm of our Greek-American newspapers the Ethnikos Kyrix out of New York, there is a gap in the microfilm. There's a 20-year gap from 1950 to 1970. This is a huge problem for anyone that's coming along.
Sure, nobody. What happened to it?
Well, it's a good question, right? So there is master microfilm that's held by a group called the Center for Research Libraries, but they don't have a public office. So, I mean, it's very difficult if you're...
And where do they keep their...
They're out of Chicago. So I've contacted them and
said... Are these Greeks? No.
No.
This is the American version of whatever they want to keep, right?
Right. They're keeping... So, and then but we have missing issues along the way, too. The libraries now have thrown out a lot of their paper holdings. And I spoke with Nancy Agris about the Hellenic Chronicle. Hellenic... Oh, we love the Hellenic Chronicle, published for 50 years. From 1950 to 2000, well, I used to go to the regular libraries and go and read, and I have a list. Okay, when I go here, I'm going to look for 1968. I want to look up so-and-so. And I called the library near where I live, and they said, oh, we don't have it anymore. We threw it out. And I went to the Cambridge Library, the Boston Public Library.
So how did they throw out something that before even they recorded it, photographed it, or whatever?
Well, they said, but we have microfilm. I said, no, you have incomplete microfilm. The paper was for 50 years, and you have 1968, and you have part of 1972. So they don't know. And again, if people don't make these inquiries, and what happens, Thanasi, is that I believe that there are newspapers in people's homes, and I know that because people call me up. I just had a fellow from down in Virginia. He's a retired professor, and he's been sending me boxes of newspapers and Greek magazines. He doesn't want to give it to the libraries because, well, they're good at losing things.
He knows exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah, they're going to throw them out, and they're not going to preserve them. So, and this is a huge problem for scholars that are coming down the road, right? Because they can't get access to things like this that give us,
This is amazing.
This is amazing. So I have in my collection, my research collection, I have about 500 clippings spanning the first 60, 70 years that I've done over the years of different things. And of course, most of it's music, but that's me. So, yeah, so it's a problem, you know, and I feel very, very bad that none of our organizations are paying any attention to this. And it's difficult for me because we have so many people saying, we're here to preserve our Greek heritage, and everything's being given to ancient Greece, but no, there's no attention, absolutely no attention being given to what's been happening the last 100 years. You know?
Yes.
So Tithagini.
Absolutely.
So in about 50 years or 100 years, they're gonna say, what were those people doing? They didn't care. They didn't save us our newspapers where we can read about the things that happened in the community, about this, about that.
Meleti, let's assume that 20 years from now, 30, mm-hmm. 50, whatever, we're all gone.
Uh-huh.
And how somebody that he starts right there, you know, the kid that hasn't been, not even born yet.
Okay, so what's happening?
He or she wants to look.
How do they do it, right?
How do we preserve it in reality?
Well, yeah, at that point it gets more and more difficult. First of all, part of the research that goes on is interviews like this. So the first big wave of immigrants that came through from 1880 to 1920, so my mother's generation, that generation is all past, or is pretty close to passing. So how can we get, firsthand accounts of and understand the traditions as they were brought over, right? So we're losing those opportunities. The musicians have died. The people that owned the stores, that ran the businesses, that were in government, that were in the church, they've all passed on. So it's going to be very, very difficult.
Are there any yayades or papudes out there that you can
go with? I have a list.
That you can go with a microphone, and I mean with a recording?
I've been doing it for years. I just got back from upstate New York. A friend of mine is still very, very sharp. He's 92. He's turning 92.
Nice.
Yeah, and he's brilliant. And he has a collection, a beautiful collection of books going back to the late 1700s. Byzantine books, and they're not just in Greek, by the way, because he was a professor. They were in German and French and Byzantine notation. So he pulled out something, Thanasi, and he had it on. He goes, "I want to show you something." It was from 1901. It was from Greece, and it was a magazine that was about on music, and it was Dimotika Tragoudia with Byzantine notation. So my eyes popped out of my head. And I said, "Gee, can I look at this?" He says, "Please, this is the only copy that I know of in existence."
Take a picture of it.
Yeah, I took a lot of pictures. And then I looked down and I saw a song that my grandmother used to sing that's never been put to record. Now I have a recording from 1950. But there that's what we're losing. Those are the connections that need to be made for the scholars.
Have you ever come in contact with the ministry in Greece?
For different things. I've not contacted the ministry. I've contacted the Academy of Athens and other institutions, but the Ministry of Greece I've never contacted, no.
Because το Υπουργείο Πολιτισμού, as they call it, mm-hmm. νομίζω ότι έχουν κάποια χρήματα
right.
τα οποία πρέπει να τα διαθέτουν
yeah.
για τέτοιους σκοπούς. And makes no difference if you are an American boy or whatever, you are
right.
totally Greek, you know, according to the Greek laws, you can go anytime you want in Greece and say, "Where's my passport?"
Because
because you are, you know, you are Greek.
Pedetis Helados.
Because you're Greek by default.
Yeah.
So, and they cannot say no to you, you know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. They cannot, right. you know, you're Greek. Yeah. I don't know if we ever should pursue something like that.
We definitely should, Thanasi. We definitely need to work with Greece in order to save this and leverage what we have in our institutions.
Even though they're going through a lot of turmoil right now with mm-hmm. money and whatever, but some money exists for these reasons. They cannot go elsewhere, you know what I mean? It's
right. They are
funds, if you wish.
They
want
they
call
are
money,
doing,
funds.
Yeah. And they have done, I've seen a lot of grants awarded to institutions over there, but we really need the people here. We really need our organizations that are saying they're here for Greek heritage
absolutely.
That, right? So anyway, so,
Για να πάμε λιγάκι πιο κάτω, because yeah. we are already, oh, this is, you know, we can be talking for days.
We always do this,
know?
Don't we?
Yeah. So. Τώρα, you told me there was a recent discovery that you did.
Yeah, this is a really interesting thing. You know, in my work, when I got back from New York, I had a bunch of things that I had to record, and in the process of, you know, going to the old records and the old tapes and, you know, digitizing everything. And I had spent a couple days on it. And then I said, you know, I want to work on my own stuff. I'm doing this for this project, that project.
Should I make a parenthesis right now?
Yeah.
What were the names of these recording companies? There was one, Kalos Discos.
Oh, Kalos Discos, yes, from 1950s.
We said it some other time, in another, you
That's
know,
right, yeah. Thing. Isn't that great?
I think it's... It's kind of funny, Carlos Discos.
Yeah. Well, and they're, you know.
And what were the other names of companies?
Like? Oh, my God, there were so many.
There were a lot of them, right?
Yeah, well, the very first ones, of course, were Victor and Columbia.
The original Victor and Columbia.
Yeah,
so they were going to Columbia and RCA Victor that became at some point.
That became RCA point. Victor. Columbia was affiliated with Gramophone. And they, from the very early times, from 1900 to 1909, 1910, they sent field engineers out to record in Asia Minor.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. And so some of those we have now, the recording logs, those tapes came back. They were actually cylinders, and they made records here, and they released them on those labels.
No kidding. So they were recorded...
Over there.
Abroad.
Yeah.
And they came in here. With a cylinder, like with a little thing that was, yeah, I know
yeah,
what you're talking
you know
about.
What
yeah.
I mean? The cylinders?
Yeah.
And they made records here for consumption. And then later on, it was Decca Records and RCA Victor, as you
mentioned. And Kalos Discos.
And Kalos Discos, and Virginia, and Metropolitan, and Elektor, and there were all these labels. There was an explosion right after World War II.
So do you think these Greeks were going to a major company recording, and then they were putting, like, their own name into it? it because they had the rights?
No.
Or they were really, they had equipment to do that?
It was a big mix mash of stuff. So after the 40s, that was really when all the independent labels, there was a big explosion of independent labels. And you could, if you had some money and you had some investment, you could start your own label. Now, Kitty Akula, who started the Panhellenian label around 1918, and I have a, I don't know if we can see that.
Let's see. Mm-hmm. Can we?
Yeah, I think that's okay.
Nobody's on. We're
on our own, huh? Where
no,
am I looking?
Go over there.
I'm looking over here. Okay, so this is Kyriakoula.
So, Kyriakoula Panhellenian Record.
Okay.
Panhellenian.
Panhellenian
okay.
was a label.
Kyriakoula Panhellenian Record.
1918. And this was an example of it. They had many different labels.
And the name of the song was Bagasiko.
Oh, yeah. Now, here we go. Are you ready for this? So this was one of the ones that was in my pile that I wanted to record. And so what I did was, on the first side, it was a beautiful song that... Tourne,
yeah. Pesto, vremaga, vremaga mu to ne. Is that the one?
Right, and it was Kyriakoula singing. Now, none of these have made it out to, they didn't make it to LPs, they didn't make it to CDs or anything like that, but they're very fascinating. And there was a violin player, Konstantinos Mavros, who apparently had invested in her company. She had gone for funding. She started with $20,000, trying to raise $20,000.
Should we see what she says over here?
Kula Panhellenian.
It's the same thing.
Panhellenian Phonograph, New York. And so what happened was I recorded both sides of the record. This guy, Mavros, played the violin. Very little is known about him, other than he ended up in the Lowell, Massachusetts area. And that his son was a musician that went by the name of Jimmy Mavros, Jimmy Maverick. And it's
Jimmy
all
Maverick from Mavros.
Yeah, he went from Mavros to Maverick.
That's nice.
And the real name is Jorga Kopolo. And they're from Vanvaku. Which is, okay. You know, Vasara, Vambaku, Vrestana. I spent a lot of time. In fact, I'm registered in the Chorio next door.
Wow.
When I was in Greece years ago. So anyway, so to make a long story, a little longer, on the other side, right? This is Mavros, Konstantinos Mavros, singing this song, Bagasiko. And it's really Ta paidia tis gitoniasu.
Τα παιδιά της γειτονιάς σου με μαλώνουνε.
That's the song, right? The first version, if you do a search right now on the internet, τα παιδιά της γειτονιάς σου, everywhere in every book and everything that's ever been written in the last 20 years is going to say Marika Papagika, New York, 1927. No, this is the first version. So what happened was I put up a clip. I was so excited. I put up a clip of the other side, and I put it on Facebook. The next morning when I woke up, I got a call from Greece. And it's a fellow over there,
and
he and his friends, they've put out some books, and they've re-releasing some of these things on CD. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, he said, could you please not put out anything, don't put anything on this song out there, because my friend paid 500 euros for that record. That's how rare it is. And he said, we're going to be putting out our CD in December. Can you please not...
Tom, yes, we do accept donations.
No, absolutely.
And ποιος είσαι εσύ και τι σε νοιάζει.
Exactly. Here's my PayPal. But this shows you the kind of desperation that people are. And he is very scholarly. And this is what they do, you know. But it shows you how desperate people are to get to this music.
Let me put it tomorrow morning. I'll put it this evening.
I'll give it to you and all. So it was a very exciting discovery, and I respected his wishes because...
This is nice. This is so nice to find out that τα παιδιά της γειτονιάς σου, it's not exactly what it was. It's something different.
Oh, he has great lyrics. Mavros sings, and there's this whole... You know, of course, the drug references back then and things like that.
Absolutely.
But the way he sings is so beautiful. So, okay, I'll take it one step further for you. So I'm doing the search, and I contacted his granddaughter.
Mavros' granddaughter?
My granddaughter. Oh, yeah.
Where's the family? They're all here in Lowell?
No, they're in the Massachusetts area still, yeah.
No kidding.
So, but she doesn't know very much about her grandfather, and she didn't have his recordings.
So you're informing her about her grandfather.
Yeah. And what happened was I did a search, and then I found a dissertation that was done in Greece.
About him?
Oh, he was included in it. This fellow contacted me about 10 years ago with a very open question. Hi, I'm doing my dissertation on Greek violinists. Can you tell me what you know? And I was like, well, geez, let me write your dissertation for you. Can you narrow it down? So anyway, I was wondering what happened to that project that he did. And he had a mention, but he mentioned that Mavros was from Vula, not Vula, what am I thinking? Above Katerini.
Oh, he Volos. Was from Volos.
He was from Volos. And it was Lathos, right? So I asked the granddaughter, wasn't it Vambaku? She says, yeah, Vambaku. So I looked at his dissertation and...
Where did you come? Actually, are you from Volos and the guy from there?
He had, I found six eras in his dissertation. And I decided I would write to him. And so I was looking up his information. Oh my word, he published a book on his dissertation. He's a teacher in a university. And so this is the problem that we're having in academia, because they don't have...
Did you notify him about those?
Not yet. I don't want to... I try to do these things privately.
Should I call him and say, I would like to attend one of your classes, but I see that you're spreading lies around you.
I know. This is the thing they don't know. They don't know what they don't know. And I looked at his references, and they were all... things that had come out in the last 20 years. He didn't go to the original records. He didn't go to the newspapers. He didn't make
Probably
the right interviews.
He did not know how to go about it.
No.
How old is that fellow now?
He's in his 30s.
Right.
But the students today don't have the critical thinking, and the teachers of the students have lost the real research skills that they need. So there's a side when I go to lecture.
Oh, because they think that they're going to find it as soon as they don't find it through the touch of a button.
Yeah.
They're not going to move their body around. That's
what
you do.
You know what I mean? No one's going to go to a library. And they pick up a book and they say, well, this must be true. I found it on Google. Well, this says that Thanasi Haberis had a department store in Boston. That's what he did. You know, you can... So this is where
absolutely,
our history
absolutely.
Is going. So this is the dark period. So this was
This is unbelievable. Yes, it is.
I'm so happy. Here it is again, folks. And...
Wow.
Yeah, so there is an academic crisis, Thanasi. There's a cultural crisis because we, the big we, are not focused on saving this history. And it's going to be a problem. It's already a problem. So the academic crisis is really bad, too. So I want to be positive, though.
I know.
I do. I'm trying to play. I feel like I'm a broken record. You know,
I know what you're saying, but you know, can you imagine if you weren't there to do this thing?
Oh yeah, this is what's happening.
You would be like
this
something that
happening.
Was covered, and that's it.
Yeah,
no more.
And I feel bad because I think that you know, we're losing this opportunity. The first generation immigrants have died; their children mm-hmm. have died. Now we're dealing with third and fourth generation people that are further away from traditions. So they don't, you know, they don't know what they don't know.
Absolutely, they don't know what they don't know.
And this is the problem in trying to
να
reach
κάνουμε
them.
Αυτή τη στιγμή ένα μικρό διάλειμμα, no. since we're talking about music,
okay.
και να πούμε τι γίνεται
oh,
την
yes.
Κυριακή. We have an event.
Yes, we
because,
do have
because
an event.
I'm afraid that we're going to forget it,
but
because we have so many
it.
Things to do. You know,
I
this,
know.
This
we
is amazing.
Yes.
So, να πούμε λοιπόν στους φίλους μας, πρώτα στα ελληνικά και μετά στα αγγλικά, ότι την Κυριακή που μας έρχεται, το Μαλιώτιο Πολιτιστικό Κέντρο έχει... How many bands are there?
Five bands.
Και μάλιστα κάπου εδώ, Μελέτη, είχα και επειδή, για να μην κάνω λάθος, κάπου εδώ είχα...
Την λίστα.
Okay. Λίστα, ναι.
So it's... Λοιπόν, I think I can name them.
Okay.
It's,
I had it here, I think. Yeah,
Inos...
Okay.
It's Rebeto Parea.
Είναι Rebeto Parea. Κάτσε. Ίνος is Mike Emanuelidis.
Yes, yes.
And his band,
his
you
band.
Know, probably they will have some of his own songs.
Yes,
I hope.
I hope.
Okay.
I hope.
So then is Rebeto Parea.
Ναι.
Oh, is Cosma going to go finally?
Yes.
Oh, he will go.
I believe Rebeto Parea is on the list. I know that...
Because I thought they were not.
Oh. Well,
I thought they were not.
Now I have to look at the thing.
Anyway,
Where
whatever. Makes no difference.
We have, here it is. But
we shouldn't be announcing things that, you know.
Yeah, no.
Okay,
no,
let's
we
see
have
I
it
have
right here. Here's the lineup. Greek Music Ensemble.
Greek Music Ensemble.
Λευτέρη and Παναγιώτα.
Είναι ο Greek Music Ensemble, ξέρουμε ποιος είναι. Είναι ο
Πάνος Λιαρόπουλος.
Με την ορχήστρα του. The Spanish music is ο καλός μας φίλος.
That's right.
Η Παναγιώτα με τον σύζυγό της.
Ναι. Ένωση is Billy Nicholson.
Οι ένωσεις έχω να τους δω από παιδί. Δεν ξέρω αν είναι ίδια.
Oh, yeah, they're
great. Billy Nicholson.
Yes, Billy Nicholson on bouzouki, his daughter on keyboards, Steve Diangikis playing drums.
Playing drums.
Yeah, and I'm not sure, because they have a couple of other people
okay,
that sometimes
okay.
play. Revma, which is Sandy Theodorou.
Yes, Theodoru. It's Sandy Theodorou. Yes, yeah. yes, with all the, with these ladies that they were doing... They have a no. They have an accordion. She's playing.
She's playing accordion.
The accordion. There's
They're
going to
have a
violinist.
Centuri. Yes, Beth Remember, is going to be
yes,
there.
Yes, 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 yes.
So this is very, very important. It's actually a fundraiser for the Meletios Cultural Center, and the cultural center was established here in Boston as a place where people could go. These musicians are doing this for free, and so we hope that you'll turn
and
out.
And the Meletios needs everybody's support. They're trying to make it an annual thing because they're saying here. The Meletios first annual Greek music festival.
Yes.
So Makis Emanuelidis was telling me that he wants to do it. They wanna do it every year,
which is good.
Which is a very very good thing for the Meletios, for the and for the society around us. You know, Meletios, how many buildings have you seen around that it's a marble building?
I know
that you can go and you know perform.
It's beautiful.
It's amazing. You know,
it's beautiful.
It's amazing.
We really were so.
Λοιπόν, να πούμε ότι θα μπορούσαν να μιλήσουν. Κάτσε να δούμε. Εδώ είχαμε μία. Είχαμε. Μπορείτε να μπορούν να πάρουν τηλέφωνο, άμα θέλουν ο κόσμος για εισιτήρια, τον Κώστα τον Τραβαγιάκη στο 617-733-0296, 617-733-0296, Κώστας Τραβαγιάκης. Στην, τον κύριο Μάικ Τερζάκη στο 617-347-4970 617-347-4970 και την Μαρία Μπινιέρη στο 617-429-1023 617-429-1023. Από ό,τι βλέπω υπάρχει και reception.
Yes, yeah, there's going to be a reception.
Το οποίο
afterwards.
Λέει είναι το κάνει sponsor η Κλίος Μαστίχα. Αυτό είναι
right.
μια κυρία, πώς τη λένε, που
Effie.
Έχει, η Έφη, η οποία είχε έρθει και εδώ, ήταν στο πρόγραμμα κάποτε.
Yeah, yeah.
Να της πούμε καλησπέρα, καλησπέρα, Έφη, μπράβο.
Yes,
και το Cretan Society of Boston, τι να, δεν ξέρω ποιοι είναι, και αυτοί το κάνουν, είναι μαζί που το κάνουν, από ό,τι
καταλάβαμε.
Μάλιστα. Για πάμε λοιπόν παρακάτω τώρα να συνεχίσουμε εμείς τα δικά μας.
Okay.
So, πες μου σε παρακαλώ πολύ, we're talking about the cultural crisis.
Yes.
That's where we stopped.
Yeah.
So let's go back a little
so
bit.
So this is, so, you know, everyone, what I do now is when I do my presentations, when I talk to people, and I talk about the lost history of Greek music, we say how important Greek music is to our identity. I also say, well, we've lost not only the music, but we've lost our history. We've lost our newspapers, our magazines, and all of these things. So it becomes a cultural crisis for us. I really think that people will look at this period in another 100 years and say it's a dark period, it's the dark ages. We really don't know. They didn't leave their newspapers
oh,
for
us. Become dark ages. Can you imagine that if the environment and the computers changes?
Right.
So they're not like based on whatever they're based now.
Right.
They're not based on Bill Gates paraphernalia. They're based on something different.
Anything could
and
change.
And then 100 years from now, not even 100 years, I think, you know, they will be saying, what happened to those archives that they were all, you know, based on the Microsoft
That's right.
environment?
That's right.
That's you, right. Do you remember Microsoft environment? It's the same thing.
Right. It's going to be it's exactly the same thing, Thanasi. So, and that's why we have to get serious about this. We have a crisis in academia. We talked about students that don't know how to do research and have the critical thinking. This is a problem. There is a funding crisis. And the crisis here is that we have not spent any serious money on archiving, on preservation. So people say to me, well, isn't everything in the libraries already? No, half of it's on the sidewalk. We just talked about the newspapers getting thrown out.
And another half ended up in the garbage.
And they don't know what they have. So when you hear that a library has received a collection, an important collection, that's wonderful. What are you doing with it? What are you doing to document that collection, to make it available for future generations? And, you know, they can't, it's just a problem. So we need funding. I have an approach. I've discussed it with, I have some very good endorsements now from people in New York. Very pleased.
Tell me something, what's happening in New York. I really want to, you know, go a little bit
okay,
more.
So what happened was I had...
Because I know there's a presentation of, it's going to be happening and, you know...
Oh, yeah, I did. I made a choice. They asked me, I had a film crew that came from Greece, and they said that the director of the project said to me, why don't you come to New York and give a presentation? I said, I'd love to. And so she said, well, you know, the summer everyone leaves. I said, let's go for it. I gave a presentation at the Cultural Center in Astoria on July 1st. Over 50 people turned out. And on a holiday week at 100-degree weather.
Wow.
And the musicians turned out. There was a lot of support. I couldn't get out of the room. People stayed for hours afterward. So I say the engagement is there. It's definitely there. It's happening. Very pleased with that. I was asked, called from that to do a six-part radio series on Hellenic Public Radio. And what I did, Thanasi, you would have loved this, was the host of the radio program, she was from Greece, she was educated here, and she really took an interest in this music and in the history, and she let me do my own thing. So isn't it nice? We laid out six programs, and that aired over the summer, and from that, we've been getting calls from people, which is
are
wonderful.
They still going on, the Cosmos FM?
Cosmos FM is the Hellenic Public Radio station in New York. They've been around for a good 20 years.
Okay.
So they've continued, and, you know, I don't know because I am here in between the two cities. So if they call me back, I'll hop on my horse, but...
I think, why not having another six-part radio?
It would be really great.
That, you know, she can do it, like, within a week.
Yeah.
Like, you can go stay in a week, like, Monday, Tuesday, Meletios will be here and talking about for 10 minutes something. You know, they can, I don't know, whatever
it
takes.
Yeah, it would be wonderful, you know, and I do like that because it helps to get the word out. I think people want to be entertained. But
and not only that, I think if you, I'm sorry for interrupting, but I think you can at the same time say, listen, please, if you see something that it's really old, there's a newspaper or something, we would like to see it.
This is what they said. They said on every program, Sylvia was the host, and she said on every program, please, if you have anything in your home, give us a call. And their phones were ringing, and then I received phone calls. So it helps for us to know that people have these collections. They don't know what to do with them. They're not going to give these books to a library where they're
nothing's going to happen at the library.
No,
There's going to be somebody, half of them will be Greek, the other will be English, and they're going to say, what the hell is this? And they're going to throw it away.
Exactly. Unless you go in with funding and you have resources that can catalog it, and the library has a plan to make it available, and people know that now. And that's why they're... There are a lot of people, a lot of collections out
there. Are the libraries interested in general, the libraries, if we give them something that's complete?
Yes.
In a form that they would like to have it, because...
Well, it's good that you mentioned, I don't know if I can announce this, but I'm going to anyway. If I get in trouble, forgive me, that we have a project that's for next year with the Archives of Traditional Music. So we have found a library, a particular library, that we're going to do a pilot project. We will donate approximately 2,000 recordings and items. It might be a photograph, it might be a tape, it might be sheet music, mostly records. We will catalog these fully.
That's beautiful.
It's beautiful, and it'll be a pilot project. Now, they've agreed on their end to receive the materials, to archive them properly, but to make them available. So
through the web.
Well, that's the discussion. That's going to be the meeting in the springtime. I think a lot of people have fear and there's misunderstanding about copyright. You certainly need to be concerned about it. But the idea is they have the spirit, so we're going to get there.
Can I ask you something? What copyright we're talking about of 1930s, or 1926, when my mother was born?
There's you know, you really need a copyright attorney when you approach these subjects. And fortunately, we've hired copyright attorneys before, so I have some experience with this. In terms of recording sound recordings, let's say that, you know, if I tape you right now, mm-hmm. In another 30 years, I own the copyright to that recording. So it's there are state copyright laws.
And you owe that because you taped me?
Yes, I put it into what's called a fixed form. So it's...
Because the only thing I remember with Journey to Ithaca, when we did our second CD.
Yes.
There were two songs by Hadzidakis.
Oh.
And I went, there was a website.
Yes.
That you go and they were asking me how many... I paid a certain amount of money
right.
to that company. Thank God I still have the receipt.
Yeah.
That we're going to make 5 or 1,000 CDs. I don't remember how many we made.
It's called a mechanical license,
yes.
right?
And
you have to do that.
And we had to tell them how many we are going to make. Mm-hmm. And I remember that we paid a very minimal. It wasn't worth talking about. You better go do it. You
right.
know what I mean? It wasn't nothing, anything.
This is the proper way of doing it.
Yes,
you're
yes,
above
yes.
board. And you actually, get down to the number of minutes, even if you use a riff.
I understand, but yeah. we're talking about Hadzidakis, who very recently died.
Right.
So if you're talking about somebody that, I mean, do you think that the family of this guy, Mavros, they still are holding the rights by nature, what's happening?
No, here? I don't believe that the copyrights were re-registered.
No, I'm just saying, you know, what's happening right now when the guy is dead for the last 60 years or something.
Well, you have to do the due diligence. You have to see, did they re-register the copyright? Did the copyright survive? They passed a law that said, which people are taking as a blanket statement, that say it's the copyright owner plus after 70 years after their death. Well, you can't say that in every case. So you really have to take it piece by piece. And what you did with Journey to Ithaca is the proper way. That's what we did when we put out a CD as a project a few years ago. This is the proper way of doing it. But I'm saying that it's not a roadblock. And certainly, if you were to come into our institution, you would have full access to this material. The problem is now, I know libraries that have Greek collections, and I can't go in and listen to these things because they have no way of doing it. I can't get in and look at sheet music.
What do you mean they have no way of doing it?
Well, they
just have the sheet music, you have to bring your own violin and play it.
They don't have a digital library.
Okay,
this is the problem.
Okay, all right.
They're not, strategically, they haven't prepared themselves. And that's why everyone says to me, why do you want to start your own music thing? Why don't you just go to one of these schools or something? Well, because strategically, they hadn't prepared themselves for
something like this.
Yeah. And the librarians out there know it, and they're struggling within a lot of administration. And so this is the problem. And then, of course, the funding problem. So it's not getting everything in the front door. Here, give us, you know, let's get that collection.
No. And actually, to be quite honest, do you remember Demis Roussos?
Oh, yeah, sure.
He had he was a musician, Aphrodite's Child.
Right.
And the most famous song that they had that was like Rain and Tears. Remember
yes,
that?
Yes, I do.
Rain and Tears.
Yeah. That's a great song.
The music of that song, it's a 1770s music of some, whatever, church music or something like that. It wasn't even theirs.
Right. Oh, see,
We didn't know. So, I'm just saying, you know, and we don't even know if they gave royalties to whom now.
Sometimes these things have to end up in court. It happened with Led Zeppelin with Stairway to Heaven. Someone recently said they were in court over that. But folk music.
Same thing with Dirlada.
Dirlada.
You remember?
Right, exactly.
It was supposedly by Dionysius Avopoulos.
Oh.
And then for this captain of this boat or something, he said, that's my song.
That is his song.
And they went, yeah.
We've surfaced evidence of it.
Yeah, and I think finally he you know, the court said, that's his song.
Yes. And these things end up in court.
Yes, yeah, of course.
But we do, you know, there's deliberate stealing, and there's sort of...
And there's stealing that it's not deliberate.
That's right. And that's how sometimes the folk music evolves, and, you know, that... Yeah, so...
A little something that people might not know, and I'm saying it right now. Yeah. I think it's Yannis Papayoannou who did the, that song about Capitan Andrea Zeppo.
Right, exactly.
Χαίρομαι όταν σε βλέπω. So everybody thought, they had a thing like on the Greek radio. I was listening to it. Mm-hmm. As we speak now, they were talking about the song, and the guy was saying, you know, the two people on the radio, they were saying, oh, yeah, that's a song about this captain, that he was always beautiful, you know, he knew that captain and blah, blah, blah. And they said, they made a whole beautiful story about the captain. And this lady calls in and goes, wait a second. This guy Zeppos was living next to us. He was. he used to go to the Bouzouki every night and spend a lot of money. That's why.
That's what the song is
that's
about.
That's what the song is all about. Yeah. He knew him because he was coming in. Right. That's true. Yeah. Zeppos was a beautiful, you know, he had all his own, all these boats.
Yes.
That they were going fishing. He had a lot of money and he was going every night to where Papayoannou used to play and throw. Throw well, lots of money, and Papa Jan said, you know what, yeah. I'm going to write a song about it, it has nothing to do with it.
See, I mean, it's funny how these things, they call it folklore, you know, I mean, it, they take on their own lives, right? Uh-huh. Who knows what will be said about us in years to come, or...
Oh, of course, of course.
But
of course.
You do want to try to get some of this as accurate as possible, and that's why I'd like to see an institution that does the preservation, but can be a credible source of information. So you could
absolutely
come.
When somebody wants to do, you know, say, okay, it's from the Boston Public Library,
yes,
which means, you know, in order to end up here,
it has to be.
There was at least, you know, they went like this, you know.
Right. But you know, like Thanasi, in the last 2 weeks, I found two articles in the newspaper, three articles actually, and there was errors in them. They were wrong. They were giving out wrong information.
As the guy is teaching now in the what's
that's the another
Greek
one.
Professor.
No, this is a, yeah, just like that. And so it drives me crazy. So I wrote to the pure person who wrote the articles privately. I didn't go out and attack them. And I just said I'd like to inform you. And here is the evidence. Here is where you should have looked. Here is the evidence to correct what you've done. Did they post the corrections? No. So history is being rewritten, you know.
And another thing that we should be thinking of is like there are some institutions that have to get involved with so many things. Mm. It's not only the Greek part of their, you know.
Oh, that's true.
But to us, it's something live and we want to do it. And you know what I mean? To them, it's probably a 1% of whatever they're going to have in there.
That's,
so what?
That's where you need the leaders.
That's why you need
the leaders of our community.
Absolutely.
To stand up.
Absolutely.
And say,
this is our heritage.
This is our heritage. We're going to, it's not about the 4,000-year-old bone, you know, and I'm not knocking, you know, ancient Greek studies or anything. It's important.
Very important, but there's more, you know.
There is a lot more.
Because between then and now, we're still alive, you know.
Yes, we are. And this is the crisis. Now, when I sit down with people, I'd say, this is what we've lost, this is what we've lost. And when you hit them with newspapers and magazines and books, I'm hoping they can
understand the severity of it. I think you said one beautiful thing, and that's the New York matter right now.
Oh, yes.
Because we have about a million Greeks there, at least.
Yes.
And they're more into a lot of things, not only music, than what we are here.
Yeah.
Don't forget, when we were kids, and I was playing in one of the bands, there was a huge page of bands around. Actually, it's floating somewhere on Facebook. Mm-hmm. There's a huge, I think you are the one who,
right.
who
yes,
put it
that's
on.
Right. The
with
from
the Hellenic Chronicle.
Yes.
With a million bands.
You remember that?
Yeah, I saw actually myself.
Yeah.
You know, actually there was, you know, in New York there were so many other ones.
Oh, yeah.
How many bands are there now?
In New York, you know, I still think Boston is a great hub for music and culture.
It always was.
Always was.
It was amazing when we came here, we Greeks from Greece,
yeah.
And we saw this Greek Americanaki, whatever, we saw them here, they were involved with Greek music. A lot of them.
Yes.
A lot, and they were playing really well. It was like, oh my God, that's amazing.
Isn't it amazing? So,
yeah.
And we still have, I think the live music scene here is more vibrant than anywhere in the country. And in New York, they still have performances. There are still people doing a lot of good things. But here we have a very vibrant and very diverse, you know, from the Pontians to the Cretans to people practicing folk music to modern music.
Oh yes, there's a lot there's a lot of things.
There's
happening.
Even discos for the kids.
There's also Journey to Ithaca.
We have composers here.
We have composers here. Absolutely.
We have composers and so, good music. Yes. So
we should make a quick note on what we said tonight because. They're telling we have only 5 minutes.
Oh, we have 5 minutes?
We have 5 minutes,
is that
yes.
It? Okay.
Maybe now it's four minutes, right? Whatever it is. Because I see that 7:50, okay.
I couldn't be, oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
So next time we're going to have about 2 or 3 hours.
I think we need a Thanasi. I know, yes. So
I think, as I said a few minutes ago, the New York thing, it's a beautiful thing. I understand that you have to go between, you know, here in New York. That's not an easy thing.
It's not, Thanasi. You know what's disappointing is, and I'm trying to understand this, is that there is a lot of engagement there. There, more so than what I've experienced in Boston. I spent many, many years here. And I really, if we don't get this done now in our generation, it's not going to happen. It won't be done. It won't be done by the third and fourth generation Greeks, mm-hmm. because they're having flaming cheese and screaming opa, and none of this is they don't
Absolutely.
Have the context.
Flaming
that we
cheese,
have.
Flaming opa.
Cheese opa.
That's what I said to a guy I was in Chicago.
Yes.
And we're talking. I'm Greek, blah blah.
Yeah.
And then I ordered a saganaki.
Oh no! Did they say opa?
Yeah. I said to the guy, listen, I'm kind of, you know, don't scream opa when you bring it. No problem, Adderfe. He comes in opa.
So. Oh jeez. Yeah, that's where our traditions have gone up in flaming cheese, and but the as generations go on, they don't have the same context that we had Thanasi. They're not. I mean, thank God we have people like Teddy and you now with the Greek program, you and Eleni, Teddy Dimitriadis with the radio program. They don't have the same context that we'd had when we were kids.
We should tell Teddy to start announcing that we need all newspapers.
Yeah,
magazines.
Oh, he did. One time he let me go on a little rant about this on the paper, and someone called in right away.
Yeah.
And he says, I have some old editions of the Atlantis, and you know, that's what we need to do. What we need to do is, and I've written to the publisher of the Ethnikos Kyriks, because I think that's in worse shape than the Atlantis. I just rewrote to him and said, look, I know where there are certain things we need to kind of put together a full collection mm-hmm. before it's too late, you know?
There is a book by the Greek Music in America.
Yes, oh, the book, thank you, yes. We have a book on Greek music in America, and it's the first of its kind. It's over 400 pages. It was edited by Tina Bukovalis. She's the folklorist of Toppin Springs. She also submitted articles. The book is available on Amazon.com for pre-sale. And it's has a lot of authors, a lot of scholars. And it's taken a lot of things that were previously published, and it's updated. They were in obscure places, and it's collected in this book. Some new research. I had submitted some articles as well. So we hope that that people will look
so
for
it's,
that.
What's the name of the book? It's University Press?
Yes, it's Greek Music in America. It's published by the University
it's
Press.
It's called Greek Music in America. That's what it's called.
That's
okay.
It.
All right.
And it came out of, it actually started a couple years ago when we were doing the museum exhibit. Steve Frangos, who's a journalist, Tina Bukovalis, and I. And Tina said, let's do a book. And we hadn't even finished one thing, but she's a good driving force. She's an excellent person, a good scholar. And she's brought together some of the finest scholars in the world, really,
nice.
To do this.
Lipon, on that note, they're telling us that we only have 1 minute.
Oh, thank
you. I would like to thank you so very much for being here.
Thank you.
And I hope that we have a lot of hours ahead thank with you, Meleti, and because this is very, very important.
Thank you.
To all of us. And I would like to also thank you for what you're doing for the
thank you,
for the Greek community here and in general for Greece. Because, you know, don't forget,
yes.
this is
This belongs to everybody.
It does belong to everybody.
We are 10 million Greeks here outside of Greece and 10 million inside. It's like, yes. You know, we're half and half.
Right.
Λοιπόν, κυρίες και κύριοι, να σας ευχαριστήσουμε πάρα πολύ που είστε μαζί μας απόψε. Να ευχαριστήσουμε και τον Μελέτη τον Πουλιόπουλο, ο οποίος πάντα μα πάντα έρχεται εδώ και μας λέει πολύ πολύ ωραία πράγματα για τον ελληνισμό που συμβαίνουν από πλευράς μουσικής. Να έχετε ένα καλό βράδυ. We'll see you all next week. Enjoy the rest of the day, the rest of the night. Have a nice night. Γεια σας. Κορίτσι πράμα.